Let's consider that we need to log all transactions in the context of an electronic wallet application. For the sake of simplification, I'm not using a complete real-world scenario here, so bear with me. The base fields for any transaction could be the ID of the transaction, the ID of the account in the wallet, the amount of the transaction in units of some currency, the currency, for example, a three-letter code like USD for American dollars or BRL for Brazilian reais, the status like pending, completed, or failed, the timestamp of the transaction, and any additional description. But imagine that we need to log transactions for wallet-to-wallet transfers. In this case, you would need to add fields to inform the destination wallet ID, maybe an expiration, for example, the number of days the transfer expires. In this case, acceptance of the transfer must occur before the start of this day, and a possible fee for the operation. And if we also need to log all transactions related to deposits and withdrawals, we will need to add fields for each transaction. Just so you know, in this example, a deposit is when we add funds to a wallet, and withdrawal is when we remove funds from the wallet. It seems our analysis is okay so far, but we have a problem. If we want a single collection to store all transactions, how to know the type of each transaction object? One way is to let all the specific fields as optional or not required, and then check if which are present in the object. For example, if you have the field destination e-wallet ID, we could infer that the transaction is related to a wallet-to-wallet transfer. This solution could work, but it's not ideal. The intention is not explicit. The developers must infer things, and it's not type safe. We could add a type discriminator field. Now, we just need to check this field to know the type of the transaction. But the issue related to the optional, not required fields remains. More than that, it's difficult to validate that all necessary information for each type is present. Here, we have few fields, but and if we have a more complex metadata for each one. So, a solution for this scenario is to use a Mongoose model discriminator. A discriminator is a schema inheritance mechanism. Note that we can say here that a deposit transaction is a transaction. We can do the same for the other types. They are a transaction. And this relationship is asymmetric, so we have the conditions to use inheritance. The idea is to have multiple models with overlapping schemas on top of the same MongoDB collection. Let's jump to coding. The TypeScript config file is straightforward. I set module to node next. This option uses common.js or ES2020 output depending on the file extension and the value of the type setting in the nearest package.json. Module resolution is how node finds the file to be imported. When module is node next, module resolution should also be set to node next. It adds support for ESM modules and is intended to evolve with node.js. Target is set to ESNext, which means the TypeScript compiler will generate JavaScript code considering the latest JS features and syntax. So maybe you need to adjust those properties according to your requirements. And note that I'm not considering any test files during the building. In package.json, type is set to module, which means we are using ES modules. As dev dependencies, besides those related to TypeScript, we have TSApp to build our project, which uses ESBuild under the hood, In this video, we are not really using TSApp because we don't need to build the project. However, if you want to explore this code, it can be very helpful. If you want to know more about TSApp, you can check the link is appearing in your screen right now. But I will also leave the link in the description. TSX to run our TypeScript code directly without transpiling it first to JavaScript. The MongoDB memory server is being used for testing. It simulates all MongoDB features in memory, so it's a good option to implement unit tests. Vitest is a unit test framework similar to Jest, but faster and easier to configure. It supports TypeScript out of the box. In our case, we are using it with no configuration at all. And the only dependency is Mongoose. Now let's look at the transaction directory, starting with the types declaration. Here we have the enums to match our scenario. Three types of transaction, the transaction status, and the allowed currencies. The transaction interface is exactly the same we have discussed in our scenario. The same for each transaction type, but note that we are using interface inheritance. Let's jump to the schemas and model definitions. We are using generics and the interfaces we have declared to provide type safety. Check now the transaction schema options. The underscore ID is to indicate that we want to generate a unique identifier when we create a new transaction. The discriminator key is the field that holds the value used to distinguish between different document types within the collection. In our case, we are going to use the values from the enum transaction type. For the timestamps, I'm considering only the created at, but with the name timestamp. We don't need to update at timestamp since it doesn't make sense to update a transaction, at least in this example. The transform function is used to modify the representation of a document when it's converted to JSON. The type transaction document is to be used as the transaction model type parameter. We are using the ampersand symbol to create an intersection with the Mongoose document class, which provides methods and properties that allow to perform operations on the associated document. The model function has two arguments. The first is the singular name of the collection your model is for. Mongoose automatically looks for the plural, lowercase version of your model name. Thus, here the model transaction is for the transactions collection in the database, in lowercase. The second argument is the schema. To create each specific transaction type, we are using the discriminator function. It accepts two arguments. The first is the discriminator value we want to use, and the second is the schema to be associated with the discriminator. Note that we are getting the discriminator value from the enum transaction type. And the schema is only considering the specific fields. Now, let's check how to use the discriminators. First, we are going to use them in a Vitest unit test. For that, we have mocked some values for each transaction. The object for each type has the fields inherited from transaction and those that are specific to the type. In the Vitest describe block, the hooks before all and after all test cases are to connect and disconnect from the MongoDB memory server. The hook after each test case removes the collection transactions. The populate support function is to create one transaction of each type in the database. Note that we are using the discriminators as constructors. The promise all awaits to all transactions objects to be saved. The test case starts populating the database with the three transactions. Then we are using polymorphism to access the description field, since this field is from the transaction interface. But in the second block, we need to use typecasting to access the specific fields. Let's run the test. Everything is okay so far, and we already demonstrate the discriminators working. But now, let's do the same test using a real MongoDB database. Besides the functions to connect and disconnect from MongoDB, the test is almost a copy from that we implemented in Vitest. The basic difference is that we are using the assert library to check that everything is okay. Before running the test, we need to have our MongoDB database running. For that, we are going to use the files in the MongoDB directory. We have a Docker Compose file and a shell script. The Docker Compose is to run a MongoDB as a Docker container. And the shell script creates the database and a user for it. Let's create and run our container. And then run the shell script. If you want to know more about how to run MongoDB as a Docker container, check the video is appearing on your screen right now. I will put the link in the description below. We are all set and can now run the application. It seems we are all good, but let me show you the transactions in the MongoDB database. As you can see, it's working properly. Different transaction structures in the same collection. And that's it for today. If you think this video has value, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe for more content. Thanks for watching, and I see you in the next video.